Om prajñāyeti natupāsitam priyamiti natupāsitam sattamiti natupāsitam anantaiti natupāsitam anandaiti natupāsitam sthiti iti natupāsita. From Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. How can we concentrate on Brahman whom we do not see? This sage says, meditate on Brahman as intelligence, consciousness. Meditate on Brahman as dear, the beloved one. Meditate on Brahman as the truth. Meditate on Brahman as the infinite. Meditate on Brahman as bliss. Meditate on Brahman as stability. May Brahman guide us and protect us and illumine our hearts. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Peace, peace, peace be unto all. This morning our subject is enter the city of Brahman, God. This body is the city, and the heart is the palace of the city. God dwells in that palace, in the heart. In the Gita, Krishna says, Ishvara sarvabhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati. O Arjuna, God dwells in the heart of all human beings. So first we shall survey this human body. What is this body? It is an incredible machine. No human beings can manufacture a human body as they manufacture car in a factory, aeroplane in a factory, and you know, so many things they manufacture in a factory. Have you seen any human body factory in St. Louis City? No. It is really something, this human body. Sometimes we do not think about it. When we have disease or some pain or suffering, we go to a doctor and we fix it. But we generally don't try to explore what is in this human body. This human body is made out of food with five elements: space, air, fire or heat, water or liquid, and earth, solid. These are the five elements made all these human bodies you see in this world. Then, how does that body function? How do you get knowledge? Through five ways we get knowledge. We get knowledge by seeing through the eyes. We get knowledge by hearing through the ears. We get knowledge by smelling through the nose. We get knowledge by tasting through the tongue. We get knowledge by touching through the skin. These are the five ways we get knowledge. Those five organs are called five organs of knowledge. Then five organs of action. First, feet. We move. This movement, goti, action, which comes through the feet. Through the hands, we work. Through the mouth, through the speech, is a tremendous action, is done through the speech. And two lower organs, organs of evacuation and procreation. These are the five organs of action in human body, every body. Next, who preserves this body? Do you know who preserves this body? Prana. When you go to sleep, your mind, your all senses go to sleep. Who preserves the body at that time? Breathing. Even in deep sleep, you are breathing. If you do not breathe, this body will be paralyzed. Just think of this whole, try to get a full picture about your body. Prana. Prana has also five kinds of prana. When the upper breath is called prana, the air is going downward, that is called apana. Vyana is all over the body, the prana is moving. Energy is moving all over the body. If I touch it here, you say, yes, somebody touched me. You can feel the sensation. Vyana. Samana, you digest food in your body. Samana. Otherwise, your food will not be digested. Udana, that ear, that prana remains in the throat. You breathe. Esophagus works. And when a person dies, this udana works like a rocket, shoots the prana to the next life. So you can understand the five organs of knowledge, five organs of action, five pranas. Then your inside there is another organ that is called antakarana. There are four functions of that organ. First, mind. With continually thinking pros and cons. Human beings always think. That is the reason we are called thinking beings. Second, we think, but who determines our thoughts, that whether it is right or wrong? Your buddhi, your intellect. I sometimes compare mind with a camera. You are focusing your lens. When the right focus comes, you click the shutter. That shatter is buddhi, intellect. Do it or don't do it. Who dictates that thing? Your buddhi, your intellect. That is called the determinative faculty. Third, chitta, storehouse, memory. Whatever you are thinking, all those things are going to your hard disk. Inside the computer is there. Millions of years, thoughts, impressions are in that hard disk. That is called chitta, memory. Fourth, I consciousness, ego. I am going to do it. I shall not do it. So these four functions we find in the inner organ. So now we have a clear picture about your body. five elements, five organs of knowledge, five organs of action, five pranas, and the four functions of the internal organ. Now who controls all these things? Who is functioning in your body? Your organs are working, everything goes very systematically. Who does that thing? Consciousness. It is the consciousness behind that all the sense organs are functioning and working. When you are dead, your eyes are open, you do not see, your ears cannot hear. So, if that consciousness is within you, within all of us, that consciousness is God. That consciousness is the Atman. So you have now a clear picture about this body and who controls it. In the one mantra in the Keno Upanishad, Kene Sitam Patati Preshitam Mana Kena Prana Pratama Pariti Jikta Kene Sitam Bachami Mam Badanti Chakshus Sotram Kau Deva Junakti. Each sense organ is supported by that consciousness. Without that consciousness, whole thing will collapse. Now we have a clear picture about this body and how does it function. Now who is Brahman? Where is Brahman? What is Brahman? How to attain Brahman? What happens when one knows Brahman? A student, when Vedanta student, went to his teacher and asked this question, could you tell me what is Brahman? The teacher replied, learn Brahman, my friend. Saying so, he remained silent. The student again asked, sir, please teach me Brahman. Again, the student repeated after 2-3 times. The teacher said, I have told you about Brahman, but you do not understand. Upushanto ayamatma, silence is Brahman. Silence. Be calm and know that you are God. Silence. All sound comes from silence and again merge into silence. This whole universe is nothing but the manifestation of sound. Let there be water, there is water. Let there be light, there is light. Let there be earth, there is earth. What are those words? Sound. In the beginning was the Word was with God. And that Word became flesh, as we read in the Bible. So, this whole world is a manifestation, name and form. First comes name. Chetananda has a name and took this form. Please tell us, how can we understand Brahman? You see, Brahman is never an object. Holding this microphone, I can say it is microphone. Holding this book, I can say it is a book. Holding the horn of a cow, I can say it is a cow. Brahman cannot be described that way because it is never an object. It is an eternal subject. For that reason, the Upanishad tells us about Brahman in a negative way. In Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, they use 22 negative words. Asthula, Ananu, Arasama, Dirgama, Lohitama, Shuklama, Krishnam. In this way, it is neither white, nor black, nor dark, nor heavy, nor light, nor long, nor short. In this way, negated. Do you know what did it negate? It negated all of our thoughts and concepts and ideas. Then what next? Silence. agrijyo nahi grijyate, it cannot be grasped. Asirjyo nahi shirjyate, it never decays. This body, your body is very young now, one day it will be old. All these bodies goes to decaying and death, all these things will come to all human bodies. We are not eternal. Bodies will die one day. Asanga, it is unattached. Asito, it is untortured by misery and happiness. Sorrows, sufferings cannot perturb this human system, this Atma. Not human system, sorry. Abang manusu gocharam, it is beyond mind, beyond speech. Mind cannot think about it. Speech cannot express it, because who will express? Atman is helping to think, Atman is helping to speak. It is the Atman, by the help of the Atman, these organs are functioning, as I already told you. Can you ride on your own shoulder? You can't. Somebody can ride on your shoulder, or you can ride on somebody's shoulder. That is the logic. Atman, you see, the thing which will express the Atman, that is the Atman. Again, they are trying to explain this Brahman, which is beyond mind, beyond speech. We want to imagine something. They say, ekam eva dityam, it is one without a second. What does it mean? It means it has no division. In this world, whatever you see are variety, multiplicity, diversity. But Brahman is one and homogeneous entity. Let me give an example. Here is a tree. That tree has the root, trunk, branches, leaves, flowers, fruits. But it is a tree. This body, she has hands, feet, head, eyes, various sections are there, but it is in one body. That kind of division is not in Brahman. Second kind of division, we see various kinds of trees. Pine tree, devdar tree, sycamore tree, apple tree, peach tree. All are trees, but variety, various kinds of trees. Third kind of division, that is the car, this is the house, this is the chair, this is the microphone, this is the book, this is the body. This kind of variety, that kind of division is not in Brahman. So it negated three kinds of divisions, Swagata Veda, Swajatiya Veda, and Vijatiya Veda. This Upanishad is telling us that there is no division. It is one without a second. Next, they try to understand, I would like to understand what is your Brahman, what is God in Vedanta. Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahman. This Brahman is the truth. Do you know what is truth? The thing which exists in the past, present and future. That is the truth. Can you show one thing in this world? There is nothing in this world which in the past and at present and in the future. This world is continuously changing. Our body is changing every day. So many cells die in the body and new cells are growing. There is nothing unchanging in this world. That is called truth. Jnanam, consciousness, and Ananta, infinite. Infinite, not finite. Please tell us a little bit more about this Brahman. Upanishad tells us, yato vai mani bhutani jayante jena jatani jivanti jat prayanta visambishanti tad brahma. From where this whole creation evolves, where it remains and where it dissolves, that is Brahman. We come from that cosmic consciousness, we are always remain in consciousness and we dissolve in consciousness. Just like waves in the ocean, waves rise in the ocean, it dwells in the ocean and again merges into the ocean. So each human being is like a wave in that cosmic, in the ocean of cosmic consciousness. Just think of that. All the time we are connected with Brahman, with God, but we are unaware of it. That is the reason we are miserable. A Brahman, Shantam, Shivam, Advaitam. Shantam. Very calm, very serene. Shivam, all good, all auspicious. Advaitam, non-dual. Sarvam, everything is Brahman. This Brahman is the ultimate reality. It is called existence, consciousness, bliss, absolute. It is beyond the three gunas, sattva, calmness, rajas, rest, action, activity, tamas, dullness. It is beyond space, time and causation. It is without beginning, without end. This Brahman, this cosmic consciousness, manifests through its magic Maya power as the universe and beings. The Shattvic, good, clean aspect of that Brahman is Ishvara, God. We call it Shagun Brahman. The Rajasic aspect, the activity aspect, all these beings, we are moving, living beings, mobile. And the tamasic aspect is the earth, trees, mountain, motionless, immobile. This consciousness is manifested in various ways in this universe. It is called Brahman because it is vast. And this individual consciousness, my consciousness and Brahman cosmic consciousness, as consciousness, both are the same. Example, this chapel space, our library space, kitchen space, shrine space, all these spaces, we give name because of this building and the use we threw by the walls, we made all these rooms. Destroy this house, it is nothing but a space. Space cannot be divided. But we divide by making walls, by making buildings. So similarly, this consciousness cannot be divided. Your consciousness, my consciousness, his consciousness, his consciousness. Consciousness is one, but it has been divided by different bodies. Where is this Brahman and where is God? It reminds me a story of one of my friends. His name was Tim Bingham in Connecticut. He's a lawyer. He told this funny story to me in 1972. He told Swami, when the Russian astronauts landed in Siberia, Brezhnev, who was the Russian president, he went to congratulate them with his limousine. So when the astronauts met him, he said, I have a very private question. Please, I want to talk to you privately. When you went in the outer space, when you went behind the cloud, did you see God? The astronaut said, yes. Then Brezhnev says, I know it, I know it, but don't tell it to anybody. Because, you know, in communism they do not believe in God. So he wanted to maintain that position. Don't tell it to anybody. Then those astronauts went to see the Pope in Rome. And Pope had a private audience with these astronauts. And he asked this question, you know, I have a very private question. When you went above the cloud, in the outer space, did you see God? They said, no, I know it, but don't tell it to anybody. Otherwise, the Catholicism will fall apart, you know. You people believe that God is above the cloud. He is seated there on a throne. That is a funny story I heard. Anyhow, the scientists wanted to explore about God. They read the Bible. Jesus said, Kingdom of Heaven is above, God is above, you know. So they went with the space shuttle, did not find any God. Then again Christ said, the kingdom of heaven is within you. We also said, this human body is the tabernacle of God. God dwells in human beings. So they dissected the body, opened it, and did not find anything. So they wrote a book, there is no God. God is neither above nor inside. Well, they are all material scientists. They try to explore God in a material way. But this science, spiritual science, is different from material science. You have to explore in a spiritual way. For example, the yogis found the six centers of Kundalini. At the tail of your backbone, that is the first chakra, Muladhara. Then above is Swadhisthana, in navel, Manipura, in the heart, Anahata, in the throat, Vishuddha. Between the eyebrows is the Ajna. These are the six centers of Kundalini. And this is the Sahasrara. This energy, this Kundalini power, the Shakti, it rises and opens all those lotuses. You do not say it, I do not say it. Ramakrishna says it. And he will tell us that what happens from that experience. How the Kundalini rises. He will tell you everything in detail. You take a chainsaw and cut your backbone, will you see that those chakras, you won't see it. Here is Brahman. Now we shall explore from the Upanishadic point of view. Hiranmayi parekoshi virajam brahmanishkalam tashubram jyotisham jyoti tatyad atma vidho viduhu. There, the stainless and indivisible Brahman shines in the highest golden sheen, which is pure, which is the light of lives. Only the Nvara Brahman knows it. Light. We are familiar with the light. How do you function in this world? Light, by the help of light. Without light, we cannot function. When there is no electricity, with the candle light here and there, your computer will not work, nothing will function. We know that when electricity goes off, we are really helpless. At that time, we understand how valuable is the electricity. We work by the help of the light of the sun, moon, stars, electricity, fire. But these lights are borrowed light. Main light is the light of consciousness. That Upanishad tells us, there the sun shines not, not the moon, not the stars. What to speak of this mortal fire? When it shines, everything shines after it. That is the light of consciousness. Again, this Upanishad tells us, I shall not repeat too much Sanskrit, Atman smaller than the small, greater than the great, is hidden in the heart of all creatures. A man who is free from desires beholds the majesty of the self through tranquility of the senses and the mind and becomes free from grief. Very confusing way. It is a smaller than the small, greater than the great. What does it mean? Here is a tiny ant and here is a big elephant. Tiny ant is nothing compared with this huge monstrous elephant. But same consciousness dwells in both, dwells both of them. In ant it has consciousness, and this big elephant it has also consciousness. There is a difference of consciousness, but the difference of the size of the body and the difference of the size of the strength. That is the reason all human beings are not equal. Somebody can defeat 100 people. We have differences of brain power, physical power. All are not equal. Upadhi tartam, difference of the manifestation. Difference in degree, not in kinds. The Bhagavad Gita gives us a very beautiful idea of that cosmic being. His feet are everywhere. His hands are everywhere. His eyes are everywhere. His ears are everywhere. With his 2 feet he encompassed the whole universe. Which is a beautiful verse. Sarvata pani padam tat sarvata ukshi shiro mukam sarvata shruti mallauki sarvam avrita tishtati. Krishna said in the Gita, he encompassed the whole universe. Again, we are always connected with God. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad or Brahman. Iyam prithivi sarvesham bhutanam madhu asai prithivai sarvani bhutani madhu. Madhu means honey. This whole universe is saturated with honey. God consciousness. Sweetness. Love. This earth is honey, effect of all beings, and all beings are the honey, effect of this earth. The bright immortal being who is in the earth and bright immortal being who is in the body are both honey. These 4 are all Brahman. This knowledge of Brahman is the means to immortality. This knowledge is the means of becoming all. Who makes honey? Bees. And again, honey makes bees. Honey supports bees. Without honey, the bees cannot survive. I remember in Mayavati, in winter time, how shall we preserve our bees, those boxes? We make some molasses, and liquid molasses, we feed them. So that they can survive in winter. Heavy snow. Again, spring comes, we let them go, and they start to make honey. I have seen in the upper New York state, in about 1,000 Island Park, those people are selling honey by the side of the road. So I asked them, you know, in winter time this place is covered with snow, how do you get honey? Well, you don't know, what do? No, we have big truck. We take these beehives and take all our bees and we take them to Florida. America can do everything, you see. Big, big truck will take all the bees from the upper New York state in the Canadian border, will go to Florida, winter time. And again, in the springtime, they will bring back all their bees and they will start to make honey. I learned a new thing there, I tell you frankly. Bees can be migrated, you know, by truck. Amazing, this country can do everything. Otasya prutasya. Consciousness is saturated in everything, in every being. But it is not visible by the people who have gross eyes, gross minded. Drishyate tu agraya buddhya sukshmaya sukshma dorshibi. Agraya buddha. Very sharp, keen intellect. They can see it. Sri Ramakrishna gave a beautiful illustration. Here is the eye of a needle and here is the thread. We want to pass it through the eye of a needle. If it has too many fibers, it will not go through. What do? You take that thread, you take a little water or moisture, you rub it. The moment it is one-pointed, it will go. It will go. Same thing, when your mind is one-pointed, it will go to God. Our minds are scattered by innumerable desires. Your shopping mall is calling you, come, buy me. Buy your winter fashion, summer fashion, spring fashion. Amazing. How to attain Brahman? How to reach him? The Kathopanishad tells us, Nayam atma pravachani na lebhyo na medhaya na bhavuna shruti na yami vaisha brinute te na lebhyo tasya atma vibrinute tanum swam. This Atman cannot be realized by reading books. This Atman cannot be realized through your good power of retention, memory. This Atman cannot be realized by listening thousands of sermons in thousands of churches. This Atman can be realized by whom the Atman chooses. What does it mean? It means if you focus your whole energy, whole mind toward the Atman, toward God, then God's mercy, His grace will dawn on you and you will see Him. You can see God only by His grace. And that is within you. A man lost his coin in his house and his house was full of darkness, he could not find it. So he went outside and there was a street light, so he was searching there. His neighbor came and asked, what are you doing? Well, my coin fell, I am looking for my coin. But why did it fall? Why did it fall in my house? Then why are you searching on the street? Because here is the light. In my house there is no light. That is happening to all of us. This body is our house, is full of darkness, ignorance. So we are searching outside God. It will not work. First illumine your heart. That is Vedantic way. First illumine yourself. Bring light inside. Again, Upanishad tells us some people try to know God through intellectual way. Upanishad cautions us, Bacho Biglapanam Hitat. na bahut bahun shastran unidhyayat. Don't read too many books. It will be it will create confusion in our minds. This man says that, that man says that, this man says that. We are continually reading this person, this person, this person, this person, you know, said this, this, this. And you are confused. Preparation is extremely important in spiritual life. Yama Digajabjat taught in Nachiketa how to prepare to attain the Atman. Nabirato Dushyaritatna Shanto Nasamaito Nasanta Manasavapi Prajnani Noinam Apniyat. When I walk, sometimes I repeat these words. First, Nabirato Dushyaritat. Your character must be good. It must be moral, ethical, and spiritual. A man of bad character cannot realize God. Character. Your acharan. You must develop your spiritual nature, sadhu nature. Dushyarita. Very clear. That means physical, mental purity. Physical purity. Then, Nashanta. Nashanta means your senses must be under control. Some people have no control over the sense organs. Third, na manushopi. You should have control over your mind. Do you know what is the difference between sane and the insane? A sane has a control over his emotion. And insane does not have control. That is the difference between the sane and the insane. You must have control over the body, control over the senses, control over the mind. Next, nashanto manasopi. Perhaps you have control outwardly, your body, your sense organs, your mind under control, but inside, just like a volcano, living volcano inside. Unexpressed, bubbling, various kinds of desires, bad thoughts, inside. It will not work. That means your mind has not yet attained samadhi. That's completely united with that cosmic consciousness. I am not a wicked person, I am not a thief, I am not a liar, I do not steal money, I do not commit adultery. Still I am not realizing God. That is the, that he means, chitta vritti nirodha. Apparently you are a very nice person, but still you are not realizing God. Why? A nashanta manasauti. Upanishad tells, still that volcano that is inside. You have not cleaned your mind properly. Still desires and doubts are peeping inside. These are the four basic things and messages. These are all preparation for self-knowledge. If you put water on the branches, on the leaves of the tree, it will not work. You will have to put water at the root. That is very important. Now we shall enter the city of Brahman. It is called Dohara Vidya in the 8th chapter of the Chandogya Upanishad. I sometimes experiment this one. Athajadi idam aspin brahmapuri dharam punjarikaksham beshmam dharo aspin antara akasham Tusmijyatanta tadanishkebhya tadvijigyansitebhya iti. If you meditate on this theme, on this section of the Upanishad, you will be able to learn how to go inside. As I said, what you see outside, that is inside. What is inside, that is outside. This cosmic consciousness and individual consciousness, both are consciousness, are same. As vast cosmic space and inner space, all the spaces are same. That he is talking about. This body is the dwelling place of Brahman, royal city. It is protected by many officers of the kings, the sense organs. Work for the benefit of the soul. Heart is the royal place. Dhaurushpin antara akasha. Akasha is the Tallingat. Brahma Sutra says this Akash and Brahman have some similarities. So they say Akash is just like Brahman. The heart is compared to the royal palace. Its shape is like that of a lotus bud. Though Brahman pervades the entire body, yet its presence is especially felt in the heart, which is therefore regarded as a most effective symbol of Brahman. It is said in the Upanishads that Brahman enters the heart as the living self for the manifestation of names and forms. Brahman is realized in the heart by those aspirants who have controlled their senses, are free from attachment to the external world, and are expert in meditation. Then the student is a little confused. What is in that akasha? In that space, you are talking about the space, inside the heart, that space, what is there? The teacher replied, Ishvatma, apahato papma, bijaru, bimrittu, vishoka, vijigitsa, apipasa, sattagama, sattasankalpa. Listen, my student. This Atma is sinless. There is no sin in the Atman. Bijaru, it has no jara, no decay, no disease, no old age, nothing, no wrinkles. Bimrittu, which is deathless. Bishoka, griefless. All these human beings, you see, they are grieving. They are suffering from unfulfilled desires. Bishoka, no grief. Bijigitsa, it is free from hunger, free from thirst. Its resolutions are true. Its all thoughts are true. Then the student is asking, my goodness, whatever he thinks, that thing happened. But yes, whatever this knower of Brahman thinks, that thing will happen. If it asks that I want to see my departed ancestors, my father, mother, brother, sister, friend, I want perfumes, luxury, car, whatever the person comes in his mind, that all of his desires will be fulfilled instantly. Do you know why? Because he has full control over Maya. Maya is the servant. I am the master. A master, whatever master orders, Maya supplies. The servant supplies. Whole universe is under his control at that time. Just see, if you know Brahman, know God, what will happen to you? All power will come to you. Then, Upanishad says, even the one beautiful woman, that also, they also will come to him. But then the commentator says, when you realize God, you don't need any women. No more desire. Because his heart is full. full of bliss, full of tranquility, complete. You remember the Zen story? That here is a cup full of tea. A scholar went to a Zen master and he poured tea, empty cup, it was full. So he was pouring more. Then the scholar says, "What are you doing? It is already full. Why are you putting more tea? It is falling on the floor." Then the teacher says, "That is the answer for you. For you. Your mind is full of ideas. I cannot teach you. You go. Your mind is full of ideas. First learn how to empty the mind. Then I shall teach you." That is a famous Zen story. This is called Arthavada. You know, oh, you will get beautiful woman and you will get lot of money if you realize God. Just to tempt you, please come and join me. This Upanishad tells us what happens. As people who do not, know the spot where a treasure of gold has been hidden somewhere in the earth, walk over it again and again without finding it. So all these creatures, day after day, go into the world of Brahman and yet do not find it because they are carried away by untruth. It is true, every night you go to God in deep sleep. Do you know how it happens? You are sleeping. You took this Amtrak train from St. Louis to Kansas City. You are sleeping. Again, the train came back to St. Louis. You got up here and said, "I am supposed to go to Kansas City. Where I am?" The train conductor will say that you went to Kansas City. It is back to St. Louis now. That is happening to all of us every night. In deep sleep, we become one with that God. For the reason, when you, after a good sleep, you get very restful and you get good energy, peace. But Swami, then we need more sleep. A stupid goes to deep sleep, comes back as a stupid. So we are all stupids. And then when illumined soul goes to sleep, he comes back with illumination. Everyone, ignorant or illumined, enters into Brahman during deep sleep. Yet there is a difference. The knower of Brahman becomes aware in deep sleep of the fact that he has become Brahman and experiences exceeding bliss, having rid himself of the pain or misery caused by the contact of the senses with their objects during the states of waking and dreaming. But the ignorant are not aware of their being united with Brahman in deep sleep. Likewise, at the time of death, the souls of body of both the ignorant and the illumined are united with Brahman. The latter, as a result of their knowledge of Brahman, attain liberation, whereas the former come back to this earth. How can we experience this Brahman? Practice meditation. Sometimes we say meditate in the heart chakra, here, 10 fingers above your navel. That is the place you should concentrate. We first, that is the gross heart, then comes the subtle, psychical heart level, and finally transcends the both heart and mind and realizes Brahman, the all-pervading consciousness. That is the spiritual heart. The image of the heart and the reflection in the buddhi becomes one with universal consciousness. Do you know what happens? You take a candle, go outside in the bright sun. This candle light will be overpowered by this bright sunlight. It does not illumine the sun. So same thing happens. This mind which is illumined, with that, when you see, try to see this way. Our mind is always focused outside. So we see all through this age, goes through the senses, we get the knowledge of the external world. Turn this mind back. This side is outside. And this inside, which is focusing on the Atman, God, inside. That is the way we meditate. We focus the mind here. Then what will happen? This Atman has pure consciousness. It is always luminous, like gem and its luster. So the moment its mind goes there, it overwhelms. And that light and other light becomes one. When the mind sees the light here, Atman's light is at the back, so you get the knowledge of the external world. That I explained in the beginning. Now the same mind is turned inward. So Atman is here. So it goes face to face like a candlelight and the sun, bright sun. It becomes overwhelmed. That happens in Samadhi. When the both light become one. Individual light and that cosmic light become one. But what shall we gain by knowing this Brahman? Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati. Knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. All name, pairs of opposites, name and form will disappear. You will float in bliss. You will never be afraid of anything or every being. You will never be afraid of birth and death or anything. You will get tremendous strength inside. You will attain immortality. You will get eternal peace. And Bhumaiva Sukham, infinite bliss you will attain. And you will, in this very body, Tada Martya Amartya Bhavati Atra Brahma Samushnute, attaining Brahman, you will become Brahman. At that time, do you know what will happen? You will be a boon, blessing to humanity. You will develop tremendous magnetic power. People will come to you for knowledge, for peace, for bliss. At that time your selfishness is completely gone, zero. You will be a blessing to whole humanity. Only love remains. You love people, serve people. The purpose of your life is over. You attain that immortality, you have attained infinite bliss that you distribute. Like the spring. During the spring all trees and flowers bloom and they give so much joy to all of us. So the life of an illumined soul is just like a spring. They make people happy. Thank you.
Atmame Shuddhantam Jyotiraham Virja Vipapma Bhuyasam. Antaratmame Shuddhantam Jyotiraham Virja Vipapma Bhuyasam. Paramatmame Shuddhantam Jyotiraham Virja Vipapma Bhuyasam. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. May my body become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. May my mind become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. May my soul become pure. May I be free from impurities and ignorance. May I realize myself as the light divine. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.